this building isn't here anymore. Fantastic, you're probably thinking, but to some people, and to me, this building is a work of art.
This is the Tricorn Centre in Portsmouth, or rather it was. It's just been demolished. People call these kind of post-war concrete buildings monstrosities. Eyesores destroying Britain's cities. But 50 years on, it's the carbuncles themselves that are being destroyed. And that's a tragedy.
Concrete brutalism, nasty, brutish, grimy and grubby. But I'm gonna make you love it.
Back in 1984, this brutalist design won the National Gallery Extension Competition. That is, until Prince Charles stuck his oar in, calling it
a monstrous carbuncle on the face of a much loved and elegant friend.
And for 20 years after that, British architecture went
carbuncles are easy to hate. Too easy. Sure, they can look depressing today, clichéd symbols of a failed welfare state. But in the 50s and 60s, they were bright, even fun, built to give post-war Britain a high-tech kick up the arse. They were made of concrete, nothing new there, but concrete so raw and naked inside and out was scandalous.
I'm just a soul whose intentions are good. Oh Lord, please don't let me be misunderstood.
This is really why I like brutalism, it's fantastic. You can really go up and touch it and stroke it. This is all the kind of wood grain pattern from the boxes that used to pour the concrete in to make the wall. It's got real texture. Makes you really want to touch it and grab hold of it.
This was exactly the point. Brutalism looked hypermodern, but its architects wanted it to feel cosy and timeless, like an old barn or a dry stone wall. It's called brutalism not because it was brutal, but from the French for raw concrete, béton brut. Its architects, like Peter and Alison Smithson, wanted a rougher, more British style of building. That's why they like raw concrete. Like rock and roll or the angry young plays of John Osborne, concrete spoke the rough, honest language of the street. And planners and developers liked concrete because, well, it was cheap and fast. Buildings like Balfron Tower by Erno Goldfinger and the Brunswick Centre by Patrick Hodgkinson made brutalism the new face of modern Britain. Not a pretty face, sure, but beautifully ugly, and definitely eccentric. And boy, did it shake Britain up. The Tricorn Centre won prizes when it opened, but a year later it was voted the fourth ugliest building in the country. Now its owner is ripping it down to build a pretty boy shopping mall.
The developer here has put up hoardings all around the building, and they say things like Tricorn down and Portsmouth up, exclamation marks. As if the building's already been demolished. But people have already started graffitiing these hoardings. They don't agree. Up here we've got one saying, I love the tricorn.
It's just like a monstrosity.
I find it an eyesore.
This one says tricorn down, says who?
Don't knock the tricorn down, it rules.
And over here we've got tricorn down, Portsmouth down. And then somebody else has come along and said no.
I think you should bomb
I'm
it.
I'm a pound
either. Bomb it.
No, what do you call it?
Knock it down.
Demolish. Knock it down.
It's been a monster, and it's a monster which now has to be put down and got rid of and forgotten, and the sooner the better.
The very name carbuncle shows how the British too often judge architecture just by the way it looks. But brutalism is gutsy stuff. You have to get inside it to appreciate it. But first, the small matter of 8-foot-high hoardings.
Building's about to be demolished, so but we're going to have a little wander around and see what we can find inside. We've got the map here of the ground floor, so we can have a look at this this city within a city. Oops.
The Tricorn opened in 1966. Young architect Rodney Gordon at the Owen Luder Partnership designed a space-age city centre to yank Portsmouth into the 60s, packed with pubs, shops, fruit and veg markets, department stores, flats on stilts and a groovy nightclub in a pod.
Right, so this is a market square. Now look at this. How could anyone want to destroy this? Up there would have been the nightclub, the Casbah. Those shafts going up there. look like some kind of weird futuristic Dalek city. I mean, look at it, it's fantastic. It's so heroic and so monumental. All these kind of great thrusting volumes and stilts and spirals, and it's completely and utterly crazy. You don't find many buildings like this in the world, and you certainly don't find many in Portsmouth like this. The big thing about this building is that you're not meant to only judge it by the looks. Looks are important, but they're only one point and one way of judging a building. The tricorn, like other brutalist buildings, is that they challenge the way you think about buildings. It's about space. It's about clambering over it. It's about touching it and feeling the spaces, not just looking at them.
It's like a cubist psychedelic film set. In fact, Carbuncles have had starring roles in films by Kubrick and Antonioni and in Doctor Who, and as the most famous car park in British cinema, the Get Carter car park in Gateshead. As a vengeful Michael Caine crashes up the ramps, corrupt councillor Cliff Brumby squabbles with his architect about his unfinished rooftop restaurant. The car park was built by the Tricorn's architects, and it's just as thrilling, with the same rooftop pods, stilts and walkways. Great for camera angles and car chases.
Jack!
The film uses brutalism to symbolise post-war optimism gone sour. Like Brumby's restaurant, brutalist architecture was often left unfinished when the money ran out. Carbuncles became that great British thing, the heroic failure. The Tricorn was meant to have hanging gardens. That never happened. People were meant to live in these flats, but that never happened either.
Nowadays, we talk all the time about living in the centre of the city, but back in the 60s, it was a bit of a crazy idea. Everyone was living in the suburbs. Nobody wanted to live in the centre of the town. Also, these flats were technically a bit of a disaster. They were stained, they were dripping, they were drafty, and they weren't a great success. But imagine, think of the fun you could have living in a pod like that. I'd love to live in one of those.
To give me an inkling of what it might have been like, I popped down to look at a little-known carbuncle by the same architect.
This is Eros House in Catford, South London, and from the look of it, it's exactly the kind of building that gives brutalism a bad name.
But I'm wrong. Not all brutalism is hated. In fact, Eros House's residents, like Adrian, seem to love it.
Why did you pick it? I mean, it's quite an unusual building to go and live in, or do you not think?
I think the building's got a lot of character.
Yeah?
Yeah, a lot of character, and the rooms are quite big as well.
Yeah.
So, yeah, you can do a lot with these rooms. But when you get in, everyone's surprised when they get inside. Yeah.
Because it's cosy?
Yeah, definitely cosy.
I mean, it's called Eros House, and is it an erotic building? Is it a sexy building?
No, far from it. definitely far from it. But I wouldn't know how to describe it. You can't.
Because it's so unique.
Yeah, it's definitely just unique. That's exactly the word, unique. Yeah.
Now you see, that's exactly what a brutalist building's about. It's about these great collisions of sculptural forms bashing into each other, completely, well, brutally in a way. And then right next to them is kind of very lacy, light, filigree glass. Central Pier. I think the architects, they may not have had much money when they were...
They squeezed out every last drop of architecture from little money, like this spiral staircase to the first floor. I walked round with Pat Hayes, a fellow carbuncle fetishist from the local council.
To me, a lot of what brutalism is about is almost about sexiness. I mean, maybe it's a strange kind of idea, a kind of architectural S&M to me. There's something quite sexy about it. I mean, but I know it's not to everyone's taste. What about, do you think, is it a sexy building to you?
I mean, it probably has the sexiness of a boxer or a rugby league player or something like that, and the slightly sort of battered ruggedness. But the name has always struck me as slightly inappropriate, I have to say, because you think of Eros as being a dainty, delicate sort of statue in Piccadilly Circus. It's handmade, it's an artisanal building. It's not a factory assembled product like a gleaming Canary Wharf office block where it is all constructed off site. And you can imagine people pouring this concrete, shuttering it fairly crudely. And again, I think that's part of the charm of it, like a dry stone wall.
If you look at that, that's just like a piece of kind of abstract sculpture. You've got this great big square block, and then you've got this little curly whirl little staircase going out the side.
Yeah. In a car lift, I mean.
In a car park out the back.
Yeah, and the back of Catford, it's great.
Back end of Catford.
If this was in the Alps or some sexy part of France, people would be queuing to come and see this building, and it'd be in the guidebooks and everything. But I don't think Mr. Michelin hasn't quite got this far.
It hasn't come down to Catford yet. No. Give him time. Give him time.
Absolutely.
Now there's carbuncle love and there's carbuncle obsession. And one couple have taken it to the extreme.
Hampstead, North London. A very posh neighbourhood, full of twee villas and pleasant terrace housing. Very middle class, very respectable, height of respectability. But lurking deep within its heart is the carbuncle of carbuncles. What you might call a concrete beast. It's the kind of house that's attracted hate mail, has caused people to go mad with anger, has caused neighbours to gnash their teeth. It's the house of Brian and Margaret Housden, and it's probably one of the most singular houses you're ever likely to see in this country.
Well, it looks like a prison. It's like a bit of Lego. Badly put together Lego, I think.
It's fun, isn't it?
It is fun. It's definitely fun, but it's very unusual.
All these boring ones, all exactly the same.
And that one certainly sticks out.
Sticks out, right?
My personal opinion is I don't like it. And the gates outside, what's going on there?
Yeah, they're new.
Looks like a bit of a fortress.
Concrete. Doesn't look nice, does it?
Brian and Margaret are an awfully genteel pair. Their house, though, is another matter. They've been building it for 40 years, battling with planners and neighbours. It's still not finished.
You come in here through the front door, and you come into this astonishing double-height space. It's a bit like walking into a cave or something like that. It's quite a surprise.
Mm-hmm.
Not for you, but for me, yeah. It's quite a surprise. Now, how do you do these kind of this moulding up here, or this casting? Or the staircase?
Well, it was done with making a timber form and filling it with concrete in the normal way.
Mm-hmm.
They did the whole of the suspended staircase, I think, in one piece.
I always feel very pleasantly enveloped and safe with the concrete. It's a good, sort of strong thing to have around me.
Mm, almost, is it cosy, almost like a cave?
No, not cosy, I don't think. It's too hard to be cosy. And the colour also, I think, is very interesting. Although I can see how some people would hate that colour, they probably wouldn't be able to live with it.
Mm.
I mean, all these sort of browns and greys, which are a bit dismal, admittedly, as colours. And I know Brian was talking about it once. He mentioned we must paint it white.
Really?
And, no. Now, that, I think, would completely take the whole thing away.
Concrete isn't a magic material. It is a simple, practical material that looks rather like frozen porridge. There's nothing magical about it. It's what you do with it that's magical.
Brian says his concrete isn't brutal, but full of poetry, symbols and character. He built most of it with his bare hands. You can even see the nail imprints from the wooden moulds. Nothing's hidden. All the guts hang out. Even the plumbing.
What do they look like? Spaghetti or veins or like a giant organ where you can sit there and play Bach somewhere.
Yeah.
It's about being truthful.
Being truthful.
In as much as they
can. I suppose many people wouldn't like the idea of living in that house with a whole set of pipes.
So this is the bedroom. It's a 1.5 height space.
Yes.
All the utilities, again, on show. Everything on show. Nothing hidden away. It's quite singular to wake up in the morning and look up at your first view, and the morning is going to be concrete.
Yes.
And then you turn up and turn around, your second view is going to be Hampstead Heath out here.
Yes.
Diffused through these kind of glass lenses.
Yes,
kind of peculiar glass lenses. It's an eccentric house.
Oh, very well.
Brian's house is unique. No wonder he wants it listed. Otherwise, like the tricorn, it could vanish. The Brunswick Centre, built by Patrick Hodgkinson in Bloomsbury, is listed. And to right, it's brutalism on a massive scale. Gargantuan terraces of flats, shops and offices, propped on stilts like a whale's ribcage. It's fallen on hard times too, but unlike the tricorn, it's going to be spruced up.
Does it feel like a walking around a big sort of stage set or an opera set or something, or a film
yes,
set?
Yes, it does. It does, especially at the first floor level, with all these cathedral features. This is very inspiring.
Yeah.
And rather unreal as well. Yeah. But when you actually walk into those corridors, what you call the streets at the upper level, then you are the camera. I never had this feeling before in my life. When my eyes are actually have the feeling that I am the camera, because of what I see is very narrow.
As if the space is scripted or directed for you.
Yes, yes, right. Yes. At night, when you've got everything lit, all the buildings lit, it does feel like being in a thriller.
The poor old tricorn once teemed with life. Great bands, and ZZ Sputnik, played in its club. Richard Branson opened his first record shop here. But the council built this fantasy shopping palace in the wrong place, and the big names, like Marx and Sparks, stayed away.
This is where you get the real sense of it being like a kind of city within a city. Look at the skyline.
It's in a right old state now, but its problems could have been easily solved. Imagine if the owners had brought in a tricorn fan like architect Daniel Libeskind to wrestle with it. Instead, they're ripping it down.
Look at the stalactites. When I came here last, it was dripping with water. And this building, one of the main problems, much as I love the building, is that the volumes, where they join together, the detailing of it, wasn't its strong point. So it let in water.
Brutalists pioneered bold new technology. And of course, sometimes it went wrong. All adventurous new buildings have problems.
Well, they made analogies to jazz. It was a bit like kind of improvised architecture. They kind of made it up on the spot as they were going along.
In 1964, some hippie architects in the London County Council decided to let rip by the Thames. They built the Hayward Gallery on the South Bank as a swinging, let-it-all-hang-out collision of shapes.
The Hayward Gallery was designed as a great big pop-art fun palace, a great climbing frame to clamber over. It's got all these walkways and ledges like this one up here. But over the years, the architect's intentions have been completely lost. They've been cut off, so you can't clamber over it like you were meant to. And it's got grimy and dirty, like this concrete here, covered in stains and smudges. But mind you, if you'd stuck the Mona Lisa right next to Waterloo Bridge, even that would start looking a bit grim after 35 years.
You'd think a building as famous as the Hayward would be listed, but it's not. It's been under threat for years. Carbuncles don't need to be destroyed or mummified. They're very adaptable. All they need is someone who understands them. Dirty old river, must you keep rolling, into the night. In fact, the Hayward's been having a makeover. Its walkways are being reopened, its concrete cleaned, and artist Dan Graham and architects Howarth Tompkins have built a new glass pavilion. It's called Waterloo Sunset, after the Kinks song. The fun palace is back. As long as I gaze on Waterloo Sunset,
I am in paradise. Every day I look at the world from my window. Here we are, right in the epicentre of brutalism. Some of the most hated buildings in London and Britain. We've got the National Theatre over there, we've got the Queen Elizabeth Hall over here, we've got the Hayward Gallery up there, all buildings which look stained and grim and gruff, and which people like Prince Charles absolutely hate. And in the middle of here we've got this fantastic pavilion which makes you look at them all in a different way. You can see all different strange shapes yourself, all distorted, and you can look through and peer out. It makes you look more intensely at the landscape and environment around you. It's quite weird. It's like it feels very intense when you're inside.
Well, this kind of intervention in a brutalist building, it looks really light and fluffy and glassy. It looks completely the opposite of what brutalism's about. But it's kind of a compliment, it's a yin and yang thing going on here.
The building's like a sort of Staffordshire Terrier, really. It's quite sort of rough sort of thing, with amazing character, with a patch on one eye. Yeah. You know? Yeah. And that's why I think you sort of either love it or you hate it, but you can't fail to have an opinion on it. However much you like the existing concrete architecture, it seemed a little bit perverse to replicate that and do more of it.
Oh, concrete,
yeah. I mean, you could have done, but it just sort of seemed not the right thing to do, and it was sort of inappropriate, because what we were trying to do with this piece is to make it open, make it transparent, give it, you know, give clues to people that you could actually come in.
Carbuncles, lucky enough to be in the right place, like the National Theatre and the Hayward, are polished up as style icons. In the wrong place, like the Tricorn, they're recklessly demolished. 80 years ago, we bulldozed stately homes. 50 years ago, we ripped down Georgian terraces. Now we're doing the same all over again with brutalism. But tastes change. In fact, new architects are building carbuncles all over again. Jamie Fobert built this house in fashionable Marylebone like a cave of raw concrete. This is 1 Centaur Street, an apartment block in Waterloo, designed by Derek Marsh Morgan. It's pure neo-brutalism. These glamorous flats sell for £750,000.
It's been voted Britain's most hated building, now neglected, vandalised, abandoned. Portsmouth Tricon Shopping Centre is finally being demolished.
Deciding what we keep from the 50s, 60s and 70s is the hottest topic in heritage at the moment. I'll grant you, not all of brutalism works. Some of it is a complete failure. But to lose some of the pottiest, some of the most fantastic, some of the most exciting architecture that Britain's ever produced would be madness. I'm just a soul whose intentions are good. Oh Lord, please don't let me be misunderstood. No. Yes, I'm just a soul whose intentions are good. Oh Lord, please don't let me be misunderstood.
That's the power of concrete. Get out! Isn't that beautiful?